additional consideration paid for by the following. Ohio Neck and Back Pain Relief Center, Scott M. Gray, D.C., across from the Marion Center between TSC and Kroger. For further information, dial 740-386-6580. Also located on the net at goodbackbadback.com. That's goodbackbadback.com.
Scott Spears along with you on the Friday edition of The Exchange, joined by Charlie Evers, Marianne Michaels, Martha Dousman-Acey, and Shannon O'Neill. Still trying to figure out what the pin is on Martha's chest. We're not really sure. I think it's a cheetah. I got a good look there, and I think it might be a cheetah.
Cheetahs don't have tails that long.
I know.
Well, where have you
ever
been?
Seen a cheetah's tail, Charlie?
Yes.
Where did
you ever
see?
Been chased by one?
Is that on the beach?
Waikiki.
Waikiki. There you go. I think it's a beautiful pin, and I think it's a cheetah, and I think the majority of people watching this program think it's a cheetah.
Oh, sure.
You like that?
Well, if it makes you feel good.
Made me feel very good.
I don't want you depressed yesterday.
I was depressed yesterday. It was a horrible day. Do want to let all the people out there know that Martha Dousman-Acey needs to be the 2011 Popcorn Festival Grand Marshal. Facebook has a page, Make Martha Dousman-Acey 2011 Popcorn Festival Grand Marshal. 70 people in 3 days join that page. So you'll want to jump on Facebook, join that page also, and let's see what we can get done. And you know what? It just should happen. So there you go. And that's all we're going to say about that today. We're going to move over to Charlie for If Marion Had Money, This Is What We Could Do.
Yes, if we just had money. Have you ever been down our alleys of Marion?
Yes.
There's one right around the corner here that you take your life in jeopardy.
Oh. What's the name of it?
I don't know. I don't know if they've ever named our alleys. I mean, I can't think of a name that would describe them except deep pits in place. Oh, my. You could lose your car in this one right around the corner. But you can understand the city only has so much money. And is it more important to fix potholes in the street or to fill in our holes in the alley? The thing is, avoid alleys. Oh.
Anybody named Alley, I just never liked. I'm going to avoid them from now on.
I would too.
There you go. It's a done deal on this Friday.
Remember the guy by the name of Gasoline Alley that used to be in the newspaper?
Sure.
Then there was Alley Oop.
Alley Oop?
Yeah.
Alley McGraw?
He had Alley Oop. Didn't he have a dinosaur? That's what you could call these pits in our alleys.
Alley McBeal.
Dinosaurs.
Alley McBeal.
Alley McBeal? Who
was there was a TV show.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, I liked that show.
Alley McBeal.
She was an attorney.
She was Calista Flockhart.
Was that in color or black and white?
I think it was in color.
It was definitely in color.
Marianne, what words of wisdom do you have besides don't go down the alley next door to this building?
Well, today I'm going to say, you don't need a loud voice to be heard. All you need is something worthwhile to say.
I know Rupert Murdoch didn't say that.
Probably not. That's also anonymous. Don't know who said that or wrote it.
Wasn't Bill O'Reilly, wasn't Rush Limbaugh, wasn't any of those guys. The louder the better. Hey, you know what? That's the way it is. We're going to move on to the current event today. This is kind of interesting. One of the striking moments, because we are approaching the one-year anniversary of September 11th, one of the striking moments of news photography from September 11th came when President George W. Bush received news that a second plane had crashed into the Twin Towers in New York City. Bush was at an event at a Florida elementary school when White House Chief of Staff Andy Card came into the room, walked over to the president, and told him the country was under attack. In an interview with National Geographic Channel, Bush says the reaction that followed was a conscious effort to project calm. National Geographic interviewed the president over 2 days as part of a week of shows airing in August to mark the 10th anniversary of the attacks. Reuters reports on the 5 minutes of the interview the network aired during a session for a televised critics association. Here was the quotes from President Bush that you'll see in the interview. "My first reaction was anger. Who the hell would do that to America? Then I immediately focused on the children and the contrast between the attack and the innocence of children. Bush said he could see the news media in the back of the classroom getting the news on their own cell phones, and it was like watching a silent movie. Bush said he quickly realized that a lot of people beyond the classroom would be watching for his reaction. So I made the decision not to jump up immediately and leave the classroom. I didn't want to rattle the kids. I wanted to project a sense of calm," he said of his decision to remain seated and silent. I have been in enough crises to know that the first thing a leader has to do is to project calm," he added. The Los Angeles Times reports that National Geographic's George W. Bush, the 9/11 interview, will air August the 28th. And there you go. That was one of the things that's been talked about since 9/11, that President Bush sat there after he was notified by the chief of staff that the second plane had crashed into the White House. Now he's 10 years later telling why he did that on the 10th anniversary. Marianne, what do you think of his explanation?
I think it's all right. It was an honest explanation, I think. I mean, you know, I see he probably did not know what to do right away. And he thought about it, obviously, and thought, well, you know, if I jump up and run and, you know, that's not going to accomplish anything. I think he did the right thing. I can't imagine doing it any other way. I don't think he could have announced to those small children, hey, well, you know, we're under attack. I don't think that would have been appropriate. I don't have any problem with that.
I don't know if alerting the children. See, here's what I don't understand. It makes it sound like the other option is telling the children. That wasn't necessarily the other option. The other option could have been get up, get briefed. I mean, he sat and continued to read the book. Now, you know what? I don't know what anybody would do in that situation,
so
you don't want to come crashing down on that. But you know what? When it takes you 10 years to respond, when the other party, the Democrats, have been using that to beat you over the head for a long, long time, it took you this long to come up with an answer. I think that's a little fishy. What do you think, Charlie?
Oh, I that was perfectly the correct thing that he did. Why anybody would complain about that, he must be nuts.
Yeah.
Now, wait a second. Well, hold on. Here's why somebody would complain about that. If you're the president and you're calling the shots, and this is the biggest terrorist attack that's happened on this country's soil, bigger than Pearl Harbor, the guy told him, we are under attack. You're the guy calling the shots. Why would you sit there? He didn't know anything at that point, had no briefing on what was going on. Mm-hmm. Why would you sit there for close to 10 minutes before you would get up, get briefs? How many lives were lost in 10 minutes on that day?
Are you sure he was there that long? I thought he got up shortly after.
I thought he did
too. No, he didn't get up. That. He finished.
He didn't? Are you sure?
How many minutes? 12 minutes, longer
12
than
minutes. 10. Oh. Well, that is a long time.
But he had others in... He's not the sole person to handle the situation. He had, you know, right down the line.
Absolutely. But, Charlie, again, why take this out of it? Why did nobody that day, when the first plane hit, when there was some major miscommunication there? I've got to go with the people. I hate conspiracy, and I hate to say that. But, my goodness, why were people not watching? You know, when Payne Stewart, the golfer, was when his plane, when everybody in the cockpit passed out, they had a Navy, some plane up on its thing ready to shoot it down if it was going to look like it was going to go down over a residential neighborhood. This was an airliner with hundreds of people on it, and there had to have been somewhere that second cockpit had lost contact with the air traffic controllers. Why are you even in contact with the air traffic controllers? If you lose contact, who cares? Nobody reports it. And not one person lost their job that day. Not one person.
I was monitoring aircraft frequencies that day, and it's very interesting to hear the pilots talking about they were ordered to land. And some of the pilots, what are we going to do? How can we land now? We're, full tank, fueled up. They can't land with a full load of fuel. And the pilots were so frustrated trying to get their airliners down on the ground.
Well, you know, here's the thing, and this is the most interesting thing to me about this whole thing. When it first happened, nobody would say conspiracy because it was such a new wound and nobody wanted to do that. When the people, the families who were actually involved started saying, hey, this is really hinky, as it progressed out, you know what? It is strange.
I don't understand what you mean by conspiracy.
Well, that, you know, why weren't any military aircrafts up in the air that day watching the World Trade Center? How come after, okay, even give me that the first, we didn't know if it was a terrorist attack. When the second one hit, mm-hmm. How come no planes were guarding the Pentagon, the brain center of our whole government, of our whole, how did that happen?
Boy, I can't answer that question.
Why don't you ask them?
They'll never tell you, and that's the thing.
Know, it happened so quickly, and it almost seemed like it was impossible that was the case. And thinking, he probably was nonplussed. I think I would be if I were in his position.
But they got planes into the air pretty quick after
they
that
did.
Happened.
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
They really did.
Yeah.
So I don't know who delivered the news to him.
Andy Card.
Oh, and he was the
chief of staff.
Okay, I don't know.
But that's why you have all these men under you that can handle a situation
right.
If you're supposedly incapacitated at the moment.
Well, he probably should have gotten up and said something to the children. I'm going to have to leave you right now. There is an emergency, and then he could have left, I guess.
And then the networks would have scrambled. All he would have had to say is just give out just a couple of words,
but
it would have been pandemonium.
But Charlie, in his own words, he says that he saw the reporters getting the news. And the morning shows were still, I mean, if we remember that morning.
Yes, it was.
Today,
I mm-hmm. actually saw it happen. I was watching
I
the
did
Today
too.
Show
yeah.
when it happened. So I was there when it happened. And yeah, that's true. There were people on the news.
It just seemed to me that the Today Show, the early show, and Good Morning America could get their cameras down there before the president could get up in a classroom and before the second plane ever hit.
Okay, now if you were president and you maybe got an idea that there was going to be another attack or another crash, would you have given the command to send a fighter plane up and kill all those people in the air? Of course, they were anyhow.
If two that
they
were
got
over,
killed.
If two, after one, no. After two, yes. Because I think then if one is veered off course, which you should know by that point, mm-hmm. that you know something's going on when two planes have already crashed that day. Shannon, jump in.
I really don't like conspiracy theories, Scott, and I don't like to believe that is even a possibility. And I know there are lots of theories out there, and they're really compelling because people put a lot of time and thought into them, but I can't criticize George Bush for what he did. I just can't, and I feel like people are always looking for an opportunity to bring down President Bush. I just, and it kind of irks me because he's a former president. You may not have agreed with his policies. You may have been irritated with what he did, but it's over. That was then. This is now. We have a whole new set of problems, and can't we just remember September 11th and appreciate the sacrifice and
hope that it never happens
exactly.
again.
Exactly. I just, why all of this? Why rehash this?
Well, because I don't think September 11th is a policy. I think when you say that you don't agree with his policies, that's not a policy. That is an event that happened that he had to deal with, and he dealt with it in a certain way. Now, you know what? Our current president, President Obama, gets beat about the head and shoulders more than any president I've ever said mm-hmm. or heard of. I don't know that anybody has come out and said, well, you know what, let's be easy on the guy.
I think that people were far harsher with former President Bush.
I disagree.
I don't know.
Go ahead.
I totally
disagree.
I go to a very liberal school. Maybe that's what I'm noticing. But I notice if I so much as share any sort of a conservative opinion in the classroom, it's like I've got 40 kids on my back saying, you know, with a lot of things they like to say.
Oh, I don't disagree with that. But if you're talking about the big one, which is the media, attacking somebody, Obama's been attacked far more.
Terrible, nasty things have been said about him.
My God, have you listened to afternoon talk radio? Yeah, they call him the Messiah.
Yeah, it's bad. It's bad.
Yeah. Charlie, come on.
They've called him everything they can think of. Yeah.
Did Bush get as bad a beating?
Here's what I've been noticing. Maybe I mentioned it before. They don't refer back to anything Bush did, really, but they always talk about Reagan. They bring up Reagan, who was president how many presidents ago? Reagan this, Reagan that. He was the ideal man. He did everything right. And they never mentioned Bush.
Either of them.
No.
Who were in the interview.
Right.
Wonder why that is.
Yeah, why is it?
Did anybody notice that George W. Bush, I believe, was the first president in office who was elected to two terms who was not asked to campaign during the 2008 election? He did not campaign for John McCain. They didn't want him anywhere near John
That's
McCain
true. Yeah.
because he was so unpopular.
Well, he didn't do very well as a president. He really didn't.
Well, there were some major mistakes. The Iraq thing,
he believed
the intelligence and weapons of mass destruction.
That war has just destroyed us.
And you talk about spending money.
Yes.
When we engaged in the war in Iraq, our billions started to go then, and they're going in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. And how can they blame a president now for spending too much money?
Mm-hmm. Now, Shannon, come in on that, because you just said, Charlie says we should pay attention to what happened during the Iraq war and where the money was building up. You said he's out of office. It's over.
Well, when we're talking about conspiracy theories and how he reacted and analyzing that, I think that's wasting time. Now, you can look at what happened during his time in office and definitely draw some conclusions about why we're in such crisis that we are in now. Mm-hmm. Yes, that's fair. That's completely fair. But analyzing his reaction, I think that when he was in the room with the children, if he had stood up and said, "Excuse me, boys and girls, there's an emergency. I have to leave." I think we'd be criticizing him for that, then, saying he should be a leader.
Have we not analyzed Bill Clinton for 20 years for what he did, which had nothing to do with policy, had nothing to do with 9/11, had nothing? Why can't we analyze Bush? Why can't we analyze Obama? Why can't we analyze somebody else?
One thing that I've noticed, you hear hardly any criticism of our Hillary. She must be doing a tremendous job.
She is excellent.
Yeah.
She's worked very hard. She's been one of the best secretaries of state we've ever had.
And you know, they were on
now,
Condoleezza Rice and all of them before.
Yeah, but I voted for, I wanted Hillary to win.
Mm-hmm.
But she didn't, and I was happy with Obama, so. She was the one I wanted to be the president. I thought that would be really neat.
Here's what I want to tie back in, and this is just a point, and it's a fact. I'm not saying that because George W. Bush did not get up for 12 minutes that he had something to do with 9/11.
Oh, absolutely.
That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is I've stated some major breakdown in security that went down on 9/11, and that black boxes. Four of them that day, to be frank with you, four of them, one in Washington, two in New York, and one in the field in Pennsylvania. Not one of them found. Not one of them. It's the only time in history the black boxes have never been found. They found them in planes that have crashed in the ocean. They found them in planes that have been blown up on the runway. They found them every other time. Never, never, never did they not find the black box. All four of those 9/11, the government has no idea where they are. Why?
Don't you think perhaps the government has them, but they, I am a firm believer in the right to know, but I think that the government in some situations, and please forgive me if you strongly disagree, but I think that if the government knows something and we don't necessarily need to know, I think it's okay to keep it secret. So perhaps they know, and they know it's one of those tastes, but we don't need to know, and I'm okay with that.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah. When you put your reporter hat on and you say, I want to know. You know what? Nixon very easily could have said, you didn't need to know about that. Had nothing to do with you. Mm-hmm. The man got kicked out of office. I don't like that because why should the government have anonymity? They're people. People run this government, and they're voted in by us. Mm-hmm. Why shouldn't we have freedom of information? Mm-hmm. What possibly, if it's for my own good, why aren't you telling me? I don't get that. Explain, maybe I'm wrong here. I don't understand.
Well, think of it this way. What exactly would be on that black box? Conversations, or is it recorded? I guess I don't really know exactly what's on there. But, you know, what if some things were said, or wouldn't it just rehash things for family members who might hear their loved ones being killed, or I don't really know what's on that black box is what I'm saying.
Well,
I
don't think it works like that. I don't think you just turn on the black box and play it.
Okay, so I don't.
What I'm saying, I think somebody listens to it, and if there's something horrible about somebody's family, you might. I mean, they blacked out documents for years with the Kennedy conspiracy and things of that nature. What I'm saying is if there was something on there that would negate the story that the government's given, that it was box cutters, and if that's what happened, fine, just say that. But why say you couldn't find them? Why do that? I don't understand that.
Are you saying that there's... I don't understand what you're thinking, Scott, as far as conspiracy. A conspiracy about what?
That... possibly it didn't happen exactly how they've said it happened.
Oh.
I think that's what a conspiracy
is. Yeah, but I saw it happen.
Oh, sure. The two planes crashed into a building, absolutely.
Right.
But what I'm saying is, why can't you answer the question of why didn't you find the black boxes? Why were there no military jets in the air that day? Why did nobody get fired at the air traffic controllers?
You mean after the first one?
Yes.
Is that what you're saying? You know... First of all, who would have dreamed that this was going to ever happen? I mean, you know, it just boggled everybody's mind that it actually happened. And so perhaps we weren't prepared. You know, we weren't sufficiently prepared for something like that to happen. And therefore, it's pretty hard to react to it, I guess.
Yeah, I think it's hard to react, and I think there's something to be said for that. But what I don't understand is why was nobody let go, and this is the fallout. Why was nobody let go? Why was nobody charged? And why couldn't you find the black boxes? It just boggles my mind that they can find them in an ocean, and they're pulling debris out of the World Trade Center, little fragments of fingernail to identify people, but you can't find the one box that is, the whole purpose of the box is to not be destroyed.
That's what you'd call a conundrum.
Yeah, and it is. And that's what it is. And God, I don't think anybody in our government had anything to do with it. I just think government, listen, let me just point this out. There's a documentary on Pat Tillman. Come on, they screwed that up. They lied to us. They said he was killed in the line of duty, friendly fire.
Mm-hmm.
And let's talk about the Vietnam War, the whole reason we went in, Gulf of Tonkin, never happened. Never happened.
We're lied to consistently.
Darn right.
You're right.
And if this is that case, then I think we should be mad, not going, oh, wait a second, the government's good. There's two very good examples of the government lying to us. And what about Tillman's family? What did you make of that, Charlie? That documentary is fascinating.
Yeah, that was bad. Mm-hmm. But going back to Bush, I don't see anything wrong with the way he acted. No, I've never heard anybody complain about it either. Scott, this is the first I've heard it brought up.
No, this is why National Geographic, people brought that up.
Oh, yeah.
People brought
it
up, and they made fun of it.
Oh.
And I'll tell you what, I'm just taking a counterpoint on that to a certain degree, but they have talked about it, and good he got to set the record straight. I want to ask the question, though, because we do have a mailbag here this week directed right for Charlie. Of course. If you were going bald, would you shave the rest of your hair off? Ronnie and Mary.
No. I think I'd leave it go away naturally. If it was going to go away entirely, I don't think I'd speed it up at all.
And the mailbag questions, irmcommunication@gmail.com. Check us out on Facebook, The Exchange Marion. Martha, you've just been sitting back taking this whole episode.
She needs to sing.
Oh, my goodness. I forgot.
Yeah.
I got so wrapped up. Shannon's going to sing.
Yes.
Let's take a look at Phyllis Diller. We'll get Shannon up to sing here. Boy, the things you forget while you're talking about conspiracy.
It's a conspiracy. It is.
I've been sitting around here in California, from Ohio, and sitting around in Hollywood, wondering, where is the international public going to find my friend, the great interviewer, Scott Spears?
Well, Phyllis, we wonder the same thing. You wonder it from Hollywood, I wonder it from here.
Well, I swear, Scott, you see, we are so aware of your great talent because you come up with hundreds of ideas. You are never wanting for an idea. You are prolific. You're always pushing. You're always there. And I thought, now, why hasn't the world found Scott and put him on a pedestal? And, you know, after all, Larry King can't live forever.
And we're back here on the exchange. Before we get out of the way on this Friday, we're going to hear Shannon sing. Martha, before we go to Shannon here, you didn't get to speak during this whole episode. What did you think of everything we talked about?
Well, I just sit here and enjoy listening to Charlie, Marianne, and you. It's so much fun as you sit
and listen.
And you know what? Nobody leaves with it. We're friends.
We are. We're always friends.
We don't have a problem. It's just
so you think.
When Charlie's not here next week, we'll know what really happened. Now, a great performance by Miss Crystal Lake and fourth runner-up for Miss Ohio, Shannon O'Neill. Shannon, take it away.
Thanks, Scott. This is Dream, A Little Dream of Me. It's my dad's favorite, so he'll enjoy this. Stars shining bright above you. Night breezes seem to whisper, I love you. Birds singing in the sycamore tree. Dream a little dream of me. Say nighty night and kiss me. Just hold me tight and tell me you'll miss me. While I'm alone and blue as can be, dream a little dream of me. Stars fade in, but I'll linger on, dear. Still craving your kiss. I'm longing to linger till dawn, dear. Just saying this. Sweet dreams till sunbeams find you. Sweet dreams that leave all worries behind you. But in your dreams, whatever they be, dream a little dream of me. Should I turn that down a little bit? Just a little, okay. Making adjustments as we go, it's all good.
Stars fading, but I linger on, dear. Still craving your kiss. I'm longing to linger till dawn, dear. Just saying this. Sweet dreams till sunbeams find you. Sweet dreams that leave all worries far behind you. But in your dreams, whatever they be, dream a little dream of me. Da 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 da. That's it.
Hey, that was a wonderful show.
Thank you.
Shannon certainly enjoyed that. Before we get on out of here this Friday, I want to make mention. When we started this show, one of the co-hosts was Fritz the Night Owl, and I got word recently that his wife had passed away. And I'm very sad to hear that. sending good thoughts his way and his family. See you next week.